Hi, this is the fourth video in our series on how to use latent gold. In this video, I will go over the different sections of output that are produced when you run a simple model. To demonstrate, I'm going to open the GSS82 data file, which is included as a demo data set with every download of latent gold. Next, I'm going to open the GUI and run a simple model with 1 through 4 classes. Don't worry too much about this interface, it will be covered in depth in the next video. When I click Estimate, the software will estimate all 4 models, and their outputs will be listed in the outline pane on the left. To look at an overview of all 4 models, click the name of the data file in the outline pane. The contents pane on the right shows some information about all 4 models. These fit statistics can help you choose the best fitting model. The BIC, which stands for Bayesian Information Criterion, is the most commonly used fit statistic in latent class modeling. Lower BIC values, or BIC values, indicate better fit. In this case, the BIC favors the 3-cluster model. The likelihood ratio, goodness of fit statistic, in the L-squared column, yields a comparison of the observed frequencies and the estimated frequencies according to the model. If the p-value is larger than 0.05, or whichever critical value you prefer, then the model fits the data well. In this case, the only model that is not statistically significant is the 4-cluster model, meaning that you have some evidence that this is the model that is most appropriate for the data set. It is not uncommon to find conflicting information about which model is the most appropriate. Model selection is a complicated topic that is discussed in the research literature and will be covered in the online course that we offer at statisticalinnovations.com. You can also customize this table by right-clicking anywhere on the table and selecting the fit statistics you want to use for comparison. To learn more about the 4-cluster model, I will click on the name of the model in the outline pane. The output here begins with a full set of fit statistics, including the L-squared and the BIC, but ranging across a number of alternatives. If I scroll down, the next section has a set of classification statistics. These statistics, and the tables that go with them, give an indication of how well the model sorts individuals into groups. The tables are useful for quickly assessing the quality of classification. The smaller the off-diagonal elements are, relative to the diagonal values, the fewer misclassifications there are. If I click on Parameters in the Outline pane, I can see the actual parameters of the model. By default, these are logistic or log-linear parameters in logit units. They are calculated using effect coding, which creates sets of parameters that will add to 0 across categories. The walled tests on the right indicate whether the parameters are statistically significantly different across the clusters. You can customize this output by right-clicking anywhere on the table. I'm going to add z-statistics and standard errors to the output. The next tab shows profiles of individuals in each cluster. The top row indicates the proportional size of each cluster. The values in the table are the probability of individuals in each group giving each response. For example, if an individual belongs to cluster 1, they have a 0.61 probability of saying mostly true, and a 0.39 probability of saying not true. The profile is very useful for characterizing different clusters. These probabilities are what you would use to label and describe the different subgroups that you find in your data. The next tab, called Prob Means, will look very similar to the profile, but the values are calculated differently. They are based on the posterior probabilities, so they come from the original sample after the model has been applied to it. Unlike the profile, where values sum to 1 in columns, these sum to 1 across rows. You can see that of those individuals who selected mostly true, 63% of them were most likely in cluster 1, and 21% of them were most likely in cluster 2, and so on. The bivariate residuals output shows the relationships between indicator variables that remain after taking the model into account. In a sense, they test the local fit of a model rather than its overall fit. In this case, the residuals are small and indicate that the variables are not related beyond their association through the latent class variable. Watch for values in this table that are greater than 3. If you find them, you may need to add more clusters or occasionally direct effects to the model to account for the relationship. Finally, the Estimated Values Model tab shows the expected means of probabilities across the classes. You'll notice that description sounds very much like the profile output, and you'll also notice that the table here is just a transposed version of the profile. That will always be true for simple cluster models. However, when the models become more complex, the two outputs will differ. The estimated values output will describe the probabilities after taking into account things like direct effects of covariance. That's a short summary of the default output. There are other tables that can be added as needed, but we'll discuss those options in a later video. Thanks for watching. You can click on the video on the right to go to the next one in the series.